Hello, welcome everybody to Sparkling Wine Week by Wine Pleasures. We've got lots of bubbles for you today. Yes, do say hello. I've got Lisa from New York there. I had one somewhere. Good. So we've got lots of bubbles today. We've got Prosecco from Veneto, from Friuli Venezia Giulia. We've got sparklers from Piemonte. We've got we've got champagne, of course. We've got cava. We've got traditional method. We've got wines from Argentina, traditional methods from Spain, but not cava. So pop that. First up, we've got sparkling wines from Italy. We're taking a look at wines of Italy with expert Giampiero, who you've probably seen on the Italian Wine Week, those of you who attended. But before we pass over to Giampiero on the wines of Italy, sparkling wines of Italy, I'd like just to look on the right if you haven't seen it already. You'll see a place where you can say hello. So we've got Yanim from India, we've got Jay from Korea, we've got Jessica from Barcelona. I know who that is. We've got Robin from Vegas, and we've got Andrea from Istanbul. We've got Lisa from New York. So very international audience. I've come into somebody now just in from Surrey in England. So English sparkling wine is not featured in the program, but we hope to see some in the future. During the course of this session, post any questions or comments that you have on the chat, and we'll get round to them before the end of the program. And if there are some we missed, we will take the questions we're not able to answer, make a blog post for them, and we'll post them up on the winepleasures.com website so that you can get the answers to the questions that that we didn't have time to get to. So let's say hello to our speaker, Giampiero. Welcome.
Hello, everybody. Hello from Italy.
And we're happy to
Can you hear me?
You.
Okay, perfect.
So, Giampiero, where are you in the world today? In the heart of sparkling wine country, I think.
Yes, in Veneto, where I live. I'm living in a red wine area, essentially, that's Valpolicella. But of course, for us, Prosecco and Durello is the usual drink we had almost a couple of times a week, I guess. So I'm here. A very hot afternoon, but some storms are coming, so we see what's going on.
Okay, great. So let's get straight into the program. I'll hand you over, put you on the big screen, and we're all looking forward to it.
So I'm starting the presentation. Just a couple of thrilling seconds, and here we are. Okay. So again, good afternoon, everybody. And welcome to this very complex for me to produce a presentation dedicated to Italian sparkling wines. It's complex like everything about Italy, and because we are, I can say, the home of diversity and difference, and especially about food and especially about wine. And we have a very long history. We are among the countries that were making wine from the past, and sparkling or just fizzy, I can say that it was the natural way to do wine in the past. It was very, very difficult not to obtain a sparkly wine when spring was arriving. And there is a very long tradition and culture about sparkling. We have news about the Romans that they call this wine saliens, titillans, spumans, spumescens. They were different kind of sparkling, of course, but they essentially identify the aromas in two kinds of fizzy wines, Aegleucos and Acinaticum. Essentially, Aegleucos was a kind of method very similar to the current the method classique, where they essentially put the must with a very high sweet taste, a lot of sugars, and they put in amphora, and then the process was going down in a very cool ambient. They say that they taken the amphora in very obscure, very fresh places, or also in submerged in the fresh water. Acinaticum was essentially the same practice, but the main difference was about the fact that the grapes were dried before starting the pressing and then the fermentation. Acinaticum now remains again as the real grandfather of reds here in Veneto, especially for the Ricciotto or Policella, where there is a very strong connection, very strong tie with this model of wine. And some wineries here in Valpolicella dedicated a lot of efforts in order to study and to develop some new ideas around Acinaticum. The word spumante was born during the Renaissance period, and we have to wait a very long time when finally, around the mid of the 19th century, some research enterprises were started to replicate essentially champagne, champagne wines in Italy. The champagne was a model, champagne was a myth. Everybody in the wine business at that time, but I can say also nowadays, wanted to replicate the model of champagne. Families and individuals were devoted to replicate this kind of model, starting from Chardonnay and Pinot Noir and Pinot Meunier, others trying with their own grapes, trying to replicate also the characteristic of their territories and of their terroirs. We can say that in Italy, probably the best place of Metro Classico Italiano was in this winery. The actual name is Conte Vistarino, and the guy responsible for the introduction of this very first Italian spumante was the Conte Augusto Carlo Giorgi di Vistarino. He was the first to plant Pinot Noir in their estate in the Oltre Po Pavese, so south of Lombardy, in 1850, and started to sell it as a Metodo Classico in 1865. That's the conventional history. We know that also these three gentlemen were in charge of innovating and pushing on with the introduction of such kind of wines. Carlo Gancia, for example, he created in 1865 a new type of champagne that was called Spumante Italiano. Then Antonio Carpenè, the founder of Carpenè Malvolti, a big winery in the area of Prosecco in Treviso. He was a researcher, a scientist. He was also the founder of the big, very important school nowadays also, of Conegliano, the Enologic School and Agricultural School in Conegliano. And he was created this Spumante Italiano Metodo Carpenè in 1880. Then Giulio Ferrari, the founder of the Ferrari Lunelli company and winery, after his studies in France, he created the first Champagne Maximum Sec in 1902 in Trento. So you see, it was a slow but constant research and aiming to replicate the idea of the spumante or the champagne. We discovered recently that there was another gentleman, the heir of the barons of Spitaleri di Muglia, that in Sicily, on the Mount Etna, in 1858, he started the very first tries on a Vin Mousseux, completely similar to champagne. It was based on Chardonnay grapes planted on roughly an altitude of 800 to 900 meters on the slopes of western slopes of Mount Etna. And in the later versions of this wine, it was joined by also Pinot Noir and other local grapes. We have news that the family Ospitalieri in those years were starting to win several international prizes with this champagne, like coming from Mount Etna in Sicily. You have to remember also that Mount Etna was the second production area in the Western world till 1910. Then the Filossera arrived also in Sicily, and everything changed. But till that period, Etna was the second production area in the world. So that's why there were people researching and investing in doing such kind of wines. These are some labels of the late 80s, 19th century, excuse me, and early 20th century. You can see Champagne Italiano and Champagne Maximum. Everybody was calling them champagne or something like that. But nowadays we are speaking of two different classes of wine. I know that I'm speaking to professionals and people that know very well, but just to remember that we have two different methods. Metodo Charmat, that we call it also Martinotti, because the merit adoption, invention and adoption of this kind of method was shared by these two guys, Monsieur Charmat and Mr. Martinotti, Signor Martinotti, researchers, scientists, both, and they essentially conceived a production made for big volumes in a big tank with a second fermentation, filtering, and then proceeding to the dosage in a similar way to the one of the Champagne was. And then the method classique or metodo classico, I'll use it the Italian way to call it, so just to help you to make more confident in the pronunciation and in the term. So the same kind of procedure that you know about the Champagne production. There is if you can permit me to give you my opinion, there is also another untold secret in our industry. Wine critics and media speaks about dry wine concept. Everybody is aiming to this kind of model. Nature or Pas d'Osé method classical wine are very popular among essentially the wine geeks, the wine experts, the wine critics, the wine writers. But the market evidence says that the consumers prefer drinking lightly sweet wines like Lambrusco, Prosecco, Franciacorta Satin, and so on. And the mild sugar wines are the key to take new consumers, especially in Asia and US. The big success of the Prosecco is based on the little bit higher quantity of sugars in the wine. And then, boom, it was a success. In Emilia Romagna, everybody drink Lambrusco since the past times, and is lightly sweeter, etc. We have a lot of evidence that consumers they don't dislike sugars. Let's put it this way. Sweetness range in sparkling wines is a common standard. In Italy, is particularly speaking about Prosecco, it is the most famous now and most important wine in the market. This is the representation of the grades of the sweetness range, and how they call it. So the admitted sugars are expressed in grams over liters. But again, we have to when we speak about Italian sparkling wines, we have to make a difference between the metodo classico and metodo Charmat Martinotti. The Italian sparkling wine industry is represented here in very few steps. So we have around 430 DOC and DOCG, or DOP as they are going to be named now under the European law. So 430 DOC, which produces 4,044 distinct wine types. The sparkling wine types on the big family are 516. They are divided in 123 Metodo Classico and 393 Metodo Chambin Martinotti. That's the big figure about the Italian wine industry. Of course, it's very difficult to obtain updated statistics, so these are the last available, and I think are related to the 2017 year. Some other key facts about the production in 2017, roughly 660 million bottles. The domestic market represented 180 million bottles, divided in 24.8 million bottles for the Metodo Classico and 100 56 million bottles for the Metodo Chambin Martinotti. Prosecco in this family of the Metodo Chambin represent the 70% of the overall production with 132 million bottles. So big numbers that they are growing till now, also under the actual crisis, but of course we have the production of 2019 that was a little bit higher, so we can expect higher numbers as soon as they are going to be available. Some hints about some other numbers, but you can find in the presentation that was available to download at the end of this hour. So you see the evolution of the Spumante DOC main areas, expressed by hectoliters in 1,000 hectoliters. So Prosecco leads the ranking, then we have Conegliano Valdobbiadene, Asti, Asolo Prosecco, and Franciacorta. Very strangely, in the official statistics, Lambrusco is not inserted. So I'll make a comment apart later about Lambrusco. But to me, it's very, very strange because Lambrusco is a sparkling, Lambrusco had a big tradition around the beginning of the last century, the 20th century, because it was produced in a Metodo Classico way with the second fermentation in the bottle that was abandoned after the Second World War when Metodo Chambin Martinotti became very, very popular. And now we are in a big Renaissance period of the Lambrusco because newcomers, new small producers are coming. They enter in the market, lowering the yields in the vineyards, and making more focused attention on the procedure of making the wine. And now we have very good products, and a small part of them are produced in Metodo Classico. So take care to Lambrusco. I'll give you some numbers later on. About the export, king of the export is again the Prosecco. You see the numbers are related to 2019. And in second place, we have the Asti and then Spumanti, generally class Spumanti DOP and then others. This is the share in about export in million euros, split by type. Leader, as you can see, is Prosecco. Of course, in this chart, you can see any number related to Lambrusco. But if production of Prosecco is estimated around half a billion bottles, so 500 million bottles, in 2017, production of Lambrusco was at 400 million bottles. So at the time, they were first. And now they are second, well soon after Prosecco production. Again, numbers about the exporting volumes and the share, and also the destinations where Regno Unito, so United Kingdom is the main market, and then United States, Germany, Switzerland, France, Russia, and so on. These are official numbers just published a couple of weeks ago. Again, in terms of volumes in hectoliters, more or less the same kind of ranking by country. Some details on the export of Prosecco. about you can see the same kind of the very first countries are the same. And Asti Spumante, that I have to remember you, that is sweeter, normally is sweeter. The main destination was Russia, and then United States, Germany, and other countries. But you can put your attention with more details in the PDF. That's a representation of the places where Italian producers are making Metal Classico wines. Some more details. The most part is concentrated in the north part of the country, central north part of the country, and we can. It's impossible to give you very very big details about every kind of area production because essentially most part of producers they love those kind of products. And they try to product sparkling in every fashion they can under official DOC law, under DOCG or under IGT, or also simple wines just because they would like to drink themselves and their friends. We have a lot of DOC that, as you can see, like Altalanga, Franciacorta, Oltrepò Pavese, Colli di Parma DOC, and the Trento DOC and the Alto Adige, that essentially they use the usual blend, let me see, so Chardonnay, Pinot Noir, and eventually some other locals or like Pinot Meunier where it is available, etc. But the normal blend is made with Champagne and Pinot Noir. Of course, the different territories gives the difference that you can find in the wine because we can go from Alta Valle d'Aosta with very high places in the mountains where they use not an international blend but Prie Blanc, a local wine grape, till for example Monti Lessini Durello. It's made with the local grape Durella that is very, very famous for very high quantity of acidity. And that's the way, because till 30 years ago, more or less, the Durella was exported everywhere, also in Champagne, in France, or in Piedmont, or in Lombardy, because it gives the right kind of acidity that you need in the wines. Monti Lessini Durello is made with Charmat and also Metal Classico, but it's a very small production and is rivaling with other very small DOC like Colliberici, Castelli di Jesi in the Marche, il Tiguglio Valpolcevera, Old Caluso that is made with Erbaluce, another very, very, very good wild grape in Piedmont. So a lot of diversity, and I'm missing a lot of them because you know they are very, very big numbers of producers that are making those wines. Look at the central south of Italy. Again, with the international wine grapes, we have Pomino in Tuscany, Colli di Trasimeno in Umbria, Torgiano DOC, and then also il Controguerra DOC in Abruzzo. We have some particularities also in Puglia, where 30 years ago, a very small winery that is called Darapri, they started to blend the Pinot Noir with local grapes like Montepulciano Rosso and Bombino Bianco. Actually, they produce 80,000 bottles for six different labels from Standard Brut to Nature, Organic, etc. And they are starting to grow a lot of interest around the possibilities, the opportunities in that part south of the Gargano Peninsula in Puglia, and that rumor says that they are going to organize a small consortium of other producers in order to produce more of these kind of sparkling wines. They are made in Metal Classico again. And then we have Sannio. Sannio is the first production area in Campania, more than 50% of the production come from the Sannio DOC, and then there they have different sparkling with Falanghina, Greco, Piedirosso, and others. They are regions rich of different grapes. You have to remember that in Italy we have more than 500 officially registered grapes that they can go in production under DOC laws in Italy. So lot of again differences and diversity everywhere. And then south, I already said something about Etna DOC, where actually it was it's part of the official law of production on Etna DOC, making Etna Spumante with Nerello Mascalese grapes. They produce also rosé, another interesting phenomenon now, growing rosé sparkling from Italy, and also in Calabria, that is very poorly known, I can say, Calabria, but for us is the heart where everything started during the relation they had with the Greek culture and domination well before the Christ was born. So it's when the scientists and researchers make any DNA analysis on Italian grapes, very frequently they found an origin in Calabria. And then also there with Montonico, they do Terra di Cosenza Dog, another great Metro Classico sparkling. But again, in the south, half of Sicily, they are producing sparkling in different fashions, international grapes, but it's very difficult to summarize in a few minutes for you. And then and very, very short representation of the Metro Classico, but let's go to Metro Charmat, where we have normally big volumes under Asti Spumante DOCG, Asti Secco, that is a new introduction, a more dry wine just to compete with the Prosecco, and the brand name of course can be put in relationship with the Prosecco name. Then we have Garda DOC, a relatively new sparkling wine coming from the western banks of the Garda Lake in between Lombardy and Veneto. We have the small production area of Lugana. They have an officially recognized Spumante DOC made with Metro Charmat Martinotti. And again, the Chiaretto di Bardolino, a great rosé Spumante. De Lambrusco, big numbers. I'm going to say you something more now. And then the big players under the brands of Prosecco Conegliano, Valdobbiadene DOCG, Prosecco DOC, Asolo Prosecco DOCG. They are the three most important brands around the world of Prosecco. More details later. Lessini Durello is the name of the Metro Charmat Martinotti, roughly 70% of the production of the area. And then again, Marche and Abruzzo with several, and Tuscany, and also Lazio and Campania with several other nice brand to discover. But before moving on, just some few words about Lambrusco. Lambrusco in 2017 was producing 400 million bottles under seven different types of wine, under seven different types of DOC in four different provinces, and with 10 different kind of Lambrusco. Lambrusco is depends on the blend of the grapes you're going to use, start from light rosé to dark violet, and but is everything is sparkling and mostly in made with Metro Charmat Martinotti. And as I was telling you before, they are now starting to introduce also the Metodo Classico, especially in the Sorbara area, province of Modena, that is really a really fine wine, just to, I invite you to try. Latest news about the Labrusco world are coming, and it seems that they are going to reunite all the consortium of producers in order to have one single body responsible for the promotion and to manage all these big area and all this big production. So let's focus on four biggest players of Metodo Classico. So Franciacorta DOCG, Altalanga DOCG, Trento DOC, and Oltre Po Pavese Metodo Classico DOCG. I'll try to summarize because this point could take hours and hours, but forgive me for eventually forgetting something or not citing something else. Franciacorta DOCG is an area comprised in the eastern, central eastern part of Lombardy, not far from Lake Garda, and is the place you see this green small area. And we can find five different kind of types of Franciacorta. The Franciacorta blend, classical, made with Chardonnay, Pinot Noir, Pinot Bianco, and the Herbamat. The Herbamat is really a new introduction on the area of Franciacorta. Franciacorta doesn't have high hills. The altitude is very, very low. So they are presumably going to suffer the climate change. And several years ago, they started to address this problem. That, in few words, I can say in one word, is related to acidity. Herbamat is something similar to the Durella for the Monti Lessini Durello that they can use in a maximum proportion of 10% by now. Gives a lot of acidity to the blend. So and also it's not it's a late harvest. It's not a very very early harvest. Just to give you an idea, they start the harvest of Chardonnay at end of July normally. So we are not probably at 4 weeks from the harvest of Chardonnay. In some of course in some years not. And not always. So Franciacorta blend is the main one. Then we have Sartène, where we have more Chardonnay and Pinot Blanc, and also it's a little bit sweeter. They introduced also the Franciacorta Rosé, where of course the technique was not to blend in the wines, but to make a real rosé. We have the version of the Franciacorta millesimato, like a millesimé for the Champagne, and the Franciacorta Riserva that are more aged wines. Altalanga, the OCG, is the second important area for the Metodo Classico Italian wines. We are in the west, in Piedmont, south of Asti, south of Alba. We can represent Altalanga, as the name says, High Langa, as the highest part of the area of the Barolo and the Barbaresco, Dolcetto, etc. They are the mountains, the hills that are facing the sea, the Mediterranean Sea, the Tyrrhenian Sea over Genova. It's a pretty big area. It's a small appellation with a very long history. Started in the mid 19th century, around the story of Gancia I told you before. It's made with international grapes, so Pinot Noir and Chardonnay grapes. Sorry, you know, in Italy we say international for naming Pinot Noir and Chardonnay because they were not born in Italy, essentially, but it's not a negative point. It's simply a differentiator, a kind to differentiate the terms about the origin of the grapes. Of course, the grapes, like everywhere in northern Italy, they stayed since the beginning of the 18th century, and they were a very, very strong develop of using those grapes soon after the problems with the Phylloxera that destroyed, like in France, 95% of the vineyards in Italy. So the international ones coming from France were the most available and most easy to plant at the time. So they had more than 150 years to adapt to our terroirs. And in several parts, like in Alta Langa, they developed a different approach, a different kind of styles and hints of in the aroma, etc. Then we have Trento DOC. Trento DOC is essentially the province of Trento. The southern part of the area that commonly abroad is called Alto Adige, Trentino Alto Adige, but you have to remember there are two different regions. They are not the same. And Alto Adige or South Tyrol is at the north, and Trentino is at the south. Again, Trento DOC is based on the work that the family of Ferrari Lunelli made at the beginning of the 20th century. And it's based again on Chardonnay, essentially, and in some parts also you can find Pinot Noir. But essentially, Trento DOC was made and is made by Chardonnay. Normally, they refer to Trento DOC as a sparkling wine coming from the mountains, and it's true because you can find very easily grapes coming from more than 400 meters till 800 meters. It's very easy in some valleys to reach those altitudes. So it's very, very interesting style and also in a very nice place to visit. Another particularity is that in Trentino, for growing the grapes, they use the pergola. It's a training, it's a kind of vine training that is very, very popular in that area, like also in Alto Adige, and like also here in Western Veneto, and not only, also in Eastern Veneto. The harvest is done by hand, and the main grapes are Chardonnay, Pinot Noir, Pinot Blanc, and Pinot Meunier. And then the birthplace of the Metro Classico in Italy, it's the Oltrepò Pavese. This is the place of the Pinot Noir, where probably we have the most important extension of Pinot Noir in Italy. It was planted by the Conte I don't remember now the name, but Vistarino, that was at the beginning of my presentation. The places are similar to the Alta Langa. It's the same kind of mountains towards the south, the south of Mediterranean area in Liguria, but we are here we are in Lombardy, not in Piedmont, and is a very clean area with no industries, very low population, marvelous hills and places to visit and to try. Now the Metro Classico from Oltrepò Pavese is becoming more and more communicated and promoted. And I think that in the very next future, because they have a lot of very small wineries, you'll be very amazed by the opportunities you can find in Oltrepò. And of course, they have also big wineries, historical wineries, cooperatives, and so you can find a lot of different products for different prices with different qualities also. So enjoy visit, enjoy trip in Oltrepò Pavese. And then we focus on the Metro Charmat big players, Prosecco DOC, Asti Spumante DOCG, Conegliano Valtrupiadere Prosecco DOCG, and Azzolo Prosecco DOCG. Prosecco DOC was born in a very small area, and then 20 years ago, more or less, It was permitted to be produced from province of Vicenza in the middle of Veneto till the area of Trieste that is on the opposite part of the region and the extreme part of the borders of Italy with Slovenia and Croatia. But the central part of where it was born was around Treviso and especially, I can say, in the Conegliano Valdobbiadene area. Prosecco DOC, so it's the largest part of the production. Of course, they cooperate and they collaborate with the other three, the other two, excuse me, DOC. But on the label, you have to remember that the product come from a wider area, so with a different, a lot of different conditions that is are all interesting to know and to discover. The grapes used for making the Prosecco DOC are essentially and primarily the Glera variety. It's a type native to the northeast Italy, and it was a very, very long history. It was known also by the Roman. It's a white grape with a traditionally with a Glera, and you can find still some kind of Prosecco done in this way. It's also a more complex blend with other, now it's permitted to up to 15% of Verdiso, Bianchetta Trevigiana, Perera, Glera Lunga, Chardonnay, Pinot Bianco, Pinot Grigio and Pinot Nero grapes, vinified of the skins, the reds. So it was a very complex grapes and the mix blend, excuse me, and the mix of the blend made some interesting differences to understand and to discover. Three essential types of Prosecco DOC. So the spumante, very low content of alcohol, 11%, as you can see. And the different, these are the parameters that you can study later. Thanks to the sugar content, you can classify the Prosecco DOC like brut, extra dry, dry, or demi-sec. Then we have the frizzante. It's lighter. With less persistent bubbles. Essentially, frizzante is maybe the little bit different techniques that in essential we have lower pressure of inside the camera where they prepare the wine inside the big cask, steel cask they normally use for the method of Chamin Martinotti. So less bubbly, but with a little bit less also of alcohol, very popular also this one. And then the last one is the so-called Tranquillo. Again, less bubbles because the procedure the pressure is less than one bar by law. And is the kind of one that is we call, yes, Tranquillo, but also Mosso, Petit Pétillon, as they say, the French, our French friends. Latest news about Prosecco are that they approved the production of Prosecco DOC Rosé. The Prosecco DOC Rosé specification are Glera and 10 to 15% of Pinot Noir. We discovered that in effect Pinot Noir was produced in the past but was dedicated to make red wines. And it was not a tradition to put in a blend like this, but because rosé now is quite popular, not only in Italy, but also abroad, they decided to address this market also putting inside the Pinot Nero. This news is very, very fresh, so we are waiting to taste the very first wines that I think they are coming from the next harvest, 2020 harvest, and so we see. But maybe I'm wrong, they are already done. I don't know, we can check eventually if you are curious about that. And then Asti DOCG. Asti DOCG is a very ancient production with a very wide range of products, as you can see. Almost four main types and the relative also DOC with the three different zones for the Vino Asti DOCG. So Asti o Asti Spumante, Asti o Asti Spumante Metodo Classico, the traditional mode, Moscato d'Asti, and Moscato d'Asti Vendemmia Tardiva, the more sweeter latest harvest. And then three different zones that are very well known. Canelli is one of the most famous, not only for Asti, but in Italy, because Moscato coming from Canelli is particularly good, but also from Santa Vittoria d'Alba and Sottozona Strelli. Back to Prosecco in terms of numbers, and then we have the more typical, in the sense that is more close area, close to the historical one area, that is Conegliano, Valdobbiadene, Prosecco, DOCG. Conegliano and Valdobbiadene are two different small cities in the area, where most of the of the industry, most of the producers, and most of the also the agricultural school in Conegliano were born, and where you can find a particularly kind of segmentation of the production. Essentially, I hope you can read it. The top is the Valdobbiadene Superiore Cartizze, that is a specific crew that is considered a subzone, but essentially is a crew of 107 hectares. This is an historical crew. Everybody knew in the past that Prosecco coming from Cartizze was the top quality, but then they were able, and to me it's a very big effort, quite interesting, that could rival with the Cartizze. They were able to identify 43 different crews under the Conegliano Valdobbiadene Superiore, Prosecco Superiore Rive. Those crews are named Rive because Rive is the traditional name that everybody, especially the elder producers, knew that those hills, those vineyards were Rive, and they have their own name. So they produce an organization of names and labels and crews that now is called Le Rive, very, very short in Italian. And then at the bottom of this higher pyramid, we have the Conegliano Valdobbiadene Prosecco Superiore DOCG that is produced in 15 different communes. That's the part relating to the Prosecco from Conegliano Valdobbiadene. These are the numbers, 7,500 hectares, more than 3,000 wine growers, 438 vinifying companies, and etc. You can read, and most part of the wine is exported. Almost the most part of the wine is exported abroad because domestic consumption is very strong on this kind of product. Sorry, the slides are very, very small, but we essentially have four different types. So the basic DOCG, the Rive, the Cartizze, and the new one that is called Sui Lieviti, on the yeast. The traditional name was the Colfondo, that's with some residues on the bottom of the bottle. Very traditional. You have to try it. It's quite an interesting new introduction. This is the representation, but you can find a lot of details on the websites of the consortio. This is the map. At the center, you can see the area of the Cartizze, and all the gray points are the 43 different rive that were identified by the consortio recently. And then we have the Asolo Prosecco. Asolo Prosecco is on the west of the area of the traditional Conegliano Valdobbiadene Prosecco Superiore. And this is a typical landscape from Asolo Prosecco. Asolo is another very historic small town, very nice to visit. Here we have essentially only I highlight this term, only small wineries, small producers. So this is the model of a more artisanal Prosecco. You can like it or you don't like it, I don't know, but you have to try it. You have to taste it because it's very frequently is different from the standard model of the Prosecco DOC, and it could rival with the Conegliano Valdobbiadene with no problems. There are several producers, but not so many. If I remember well, we are around 35, 36 producers in the Asolo Prosecco DOCG. It's also a very nice place to visit with a lot of Venetian villas, and those landscapes are very, very common, are familiar to me, and I love very much going to the Asolo Prosecco DOCG, not only for the wine, but also for the people, and like everywhere in Veneto, I have to say, but of course, it's Asolo is a very nice place. So, I finished with this very long trip, and I've missed a lot of places, a lot of wines, but I'm here for your questions if you have, and to answer to your curiosity essentially. So thank you for your attention. Here we are for your questions.
Thank you. It's very informative. Myself, let's turn the slides off a moment. There we go. So let's have a look. Okay, so we might get some questions, but we only got 5 minutes. You said that Prosecco, there's Spumante, there's Frizzante and Tranquillo, but of the total production, what percentages are they produced? Spumante, Frizzante, Tranquillo?
The main part goes to the Spumante, for sure. I don't know the split. You have to answer. We have to ask to the consortium, because the official numbers are very difficult to collect.
Right. Okay.
But normally, what you find on the market is the Spumante abroad, Tranquillo, and the Fizzi, the second one. You can find more locally, especially in Treviso area or around, or in Veneto, or in Northeast Italy.
Right, well, Jessica's asking a question here. Let's see if we can get them in quickly. There are so many types of sparkling wines of Italy. To a US market, what are three new sparkling wines to look for in the wine sections of grocery stores?
Again, it depends on what we are looking for, metodo classico or metodo Charmat. If we are speaking of metodo classico, for sure you can't miss any of the four I already cited. So Franciacorta, very small production from Alto Adige, Trento DOC, Alta Langa, and now it's coming, so look for it also from Oltre Po Pavese. They started to promote it and to organize the production. There is a new director coming from the Lugana Consortio with a lot of new ideas, and they want to renovate the area, so look for also for Oltre Po. But also, great Spumante coming from Etna, from Mount Etna, from Puglia, or from Abruzzo and Marche, and something also in Tuscany, and Lazio also. So it's very, very, I forget Sanio from from Campania. So it's very difficult. You know, what you find at the store in US or in another country is not always the best. It's what the importers want to push and in terms also of quantities and volumes. So I suggest to make a contact with the producers in Italy and try to follow the line till your local store, or eventually generate a demand from your local store in order to grow it. That's the way like natural wine started in New York, in Manhattan and Brooklyn some years ago. They started pushing from the grassroots level, and then the good wines, they found naturally, let's say, an importer, a retailer, a distributor, etc. So now we have the power as consumers, you know, we can create a demand from grassroots level. That's my opinion.
Okay, Lisa is asking, why do you think that Franciacorta, if indeed it is the case, trend is sales are going down? Why do you think that might be?
Franciacorta is, that's my opinion, they are in the middle of a transition. When they started with a wider area, so they were in very few years, they started to produce more. And now, you know, that's coupled with also some difficulties due to some very difficult harvest they had with hail storms, with lowering production, etc. And of course, climatic change is also a factor. But they reacted very well, and they are introducing this new grape that I think is going to make the Franciacorta more fresh, more drinkable, and more interesting. Of course, we have, especially in the internal area of production around the Iseo Lake, you can find several big and also small wineries. They are defending themselves on the market very well, and the product is very, very, very good to taste and to try. So Franciacorta is still the big horse for the Metro Classico in Italy, for sure.
Okay, and last question, Domenico. Prosecco Doc Assolo is divided into two areas, Quale Assolani and Montello. Could you tell us the main differences?
Quale Assolani is the area where the sparkling are produced. Montello is more related to different grapes and also to produce red ones. Montello is very famous for red wines, especially.
Okay, great. So let's come get back together again. Thank you very much, Gian Piero. It's been most enlightening, and people who watched it, I'm sure we'll be watching again because there's a lot of information in there on sparkling wines from Italy. I think we do have a handout for you, so I can. My colleague behind the scenes is watching. We can put that up for downloading the file of the presentation.
Okay.
Yeah. So if you want to quickly take that, got about 1 minute.
yes. What can I say more? Again, as usual in Italy, wine is a very complex argument to study and to know. We too that we live here, for us it's impossible to know everything and everybody in the industry. Because every 5 kilometers on your road, you can find different wines, different DOC, different types, different colors, different method of production, etc. So what you need to do is to come here to visit the country, visit our regions from south to north, everywhere, and study, because Italy is not simple, let me say, like France or Spain, where decades of cultural research conducted to reduce the amount of grapes, reduce the kind of wines they have. We have a different history. For us, it's more difficult to stay on the market, I know, because we have a lot of complexity, a lot of differences to propose. It is very difficult. Someone wants to reduce this complexity, someone wants to maintain the complexity. I think it's better the second, because nobody else in the world has this kind of wide range of kind of products. But you have to come here, break your lockdown as soon as possible, and we are waiting for you and to enjoy the good wines with you, and maybe bring your bottles also, and we can share some good wine culture all together.
Okay, great. So next up then, we've got the link we just put at the top there. You can, if you click on the link for the next session, which have live interviews with sparkling wine producers from Italy. That's two Prosecco producers and one from Piemonte. but all three work in the Charmat method. So click on the link there. We'll be back at 4:15 local time in Spain and Italy. And we hope to see you then. Thank you very much, Giampiero, and we look forward to your expertise in a future edition. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody. And thank you for your passion and for being so focused on this webinar. Thank you again.
Okay, so we'll see you in the next session, 15 minutes from now. Bye for now.
Bye.